Book 7, Odysseus at the Court of Alcinous in Phaeacia. So Lord Odysseus, who had endured so much, prayed there, while two strong mules took the girl into the city. Then Odysseus got up and set off for the city. Odysseus moved towards Alcinous's splendid home. The Phaeacians, so celebrated for their ships, did not see him as he moved across the city in their midst. Athena, fair-haired, fearful goddess, would not permit that. Her heart cared for him, so she cast around him an amazing mist. Odysseus moved towards Alcinous' splendid home, house. Above the high vaulted home of brave Alcinous, there was a radiance as if from sun or moon. Bronze walls extended out beyond the threshold in various directions to the inner rooms. They had a blue enamel cornice. Golden doors blocked the way into the well-constructed palace. The bronze threshold had silver doorposts set inside and a silver lintel. The handles were of gold. On both sides of the door stood gold and silver dogs, immortal creatures who would never age, created by Hephaestus's matchless artistry to guard the palace of brave-hearted Alcinous. Lord Odysseus, who had endured so much, stood there and gazed around. When his heart had marveled at it all, he moved fast across the threshold into the house. Long-suffering Lord Odysseus, still enclosed in mist, the thick covering poured around him by Athena, went to the hall until he came to Arete and Alcinous the king. With his arms, Odysseus embraced the knees of Arete, and at that moment the miraculous mist dissolved away from him. The people in the palace were all silent as they gazed upon the man, struck with wonder at the sight. Odysseus then made his entreaty. Arete, daughter of godlike Rhexenor, I've come to you and to your husband here, to your knees, in supplication to you, a man who's experienced so much distress, and to those feasting here. May gods grant them happiness in life, and may they each pass on riches in their homes to all their children, and noble honors given by the people. Please rouse yourself to help me return home, to get back quickly to my native land. I've been suffering trouble for a long time, so far away from friends. When he heard these words, brave and kingly Alcinous stretched out his hand, reached for Odysseus, that wise and crafty man, raised him from the hearth, and invited him to sit. Then noble Alcinous spoke to his herald. Pontonius, prepare wine in the mixing bowl, then serve it all to the people in the hall, so we may pour libations out to Zeus, who loves lightning, for he accompanies all pious suppliants. Once Alcinous said this, Pontonius prepared the honeyed wine, and then poured the first drops for libation into every cup. When they made their offering and drunk their fill of wine, Alcinous then addressed the gathering and said, You Phaeacians, counselors, and leaders, pay attention to me so I can say what the heart here in my chest commands. Now that you have all finished eating, return back to your homes and get some rest. In the morning, we'll summon an assembly with more elders, entertain the stranger here in our home, and also sacrifice choice offerings to the gods. Then after that, we'll think about how we can send him off so that the stranger, with us escorting him and without further pain or effort, may reach his native land, no matter how far distant. Meanwhile, he'll not suffer harm or trouble, not before he sets foot on his own land. After that, he'll undergo all those things, destiny and the dreaded spinning fate spun in the thread for him when he was born, when his mother gave him birth. However, if he's a deathless one come down from heaven, then gods are planning something different. Resourceful Odysseus then answered Alcinous, Alcinous, you should not concern yourself about what you've just said, for I am not like the immortal gods who hold white heaven, not in any form or shape. I am like mortal men. Indeed, I could recount a longer story, all those hardships that I had to suffer from the gods, but let me eat my dinner, though I'm in great distress, for there's nothing more shameless than a wretched stomach which commands a man to think about his needs, even if he's really sad or troubles weigh down his heart, just the way my spirit is now full of sorrow. Yet my belly is always telling me to eat and drink, forgetting everything I've had to bear, and ordering me to stuff myself with food. But when dawn appears, you should stir yourself so you can set me in my misery back on my native soil. For all I've suffered, if I can see my goods again, my slaves, my large and high-roof home, then let life end. Once Odysseus finished, they all approved his words, and because he'd spoken well and to the point, they ordered that their guests should be sent on his way. Summary. Odysseus tells Alcinous and Arete the story of his voyage from Calypso's island to Phaeacia and his treatment by Nausicaa. And summary. Book 8. Odysseus is entertained in Phaeacia. The next day, Alcinous addressed them all and said to the Phaeacians, Listen to me, you Phaeacian counselors and leaders. I'll tell you what the heart in my chest says. This stranger here, a man I do not know, a wanderer, has traveled to my house. He's asking to be sent away back home and has requested confirmation from us. So let us act as we have done before and assist him in his journey. No man arriving at my palace stays there long, grieving, because he can't return back home. Alcinous spoke and led them off. The sceptred kings came after him, while Harald went to find the godlike singer. 52 hand-picked young men went off, as Alcinous had ordered, to the shore beside the restless sea. Once they reached the boat, they dragged the black ship into the deeper water, set the masts and sails in place inside the vessel, lashed the rowing oars into their leather pivots, then hoisted the white sail. Next, they moored the ship well off the sea, and then returned to the great home of their wise king. Halls, corridors, and courtyards were full of people gathering, a massive crowd, young and old. On their behalf, Alcinous slaughtered 8 white-tusked boars, 2 shambling oxen, and 12 sheep. These carcasses they skinned and dressed and prepared a splendid banquet. Meanwhile, the herald was returning with the loyal singer, a man the muse so loved above all others. She'd given him both bad and good, for she destroyed his eyes, but had bestowed on him the gift of pleasing song. The herald, Pontanus, then brought up a silver-studded chair for him. Once they enjoyed their hearts full of food and drink, the minstrel Demodocus, inspired by the muse, sang about the glorious deeds of warriors, that tale whose fame had climbed to spacious heaven, about Odysseus and Achilles, son of Peleus, when at a lavish feast in honor of the gods, they fought each other in ferocious argument. This was the song the celebrated minstrel sang. Alcinous then asked Laodamas and Halias to dance alone. No man could match their dancing skill. The two men picked up a lovely purple ball. Then, leaning back, one of them would throw it high towards the shadowy clouds, and then the other, before his feet touched the ground, would catch it easily. Once they'd shown their skill in tossing it straight up, they threw it back and forth as they kept dancing on the life-sustaining hearth, while more young men stood at the edge of the arena beating time. The dancing rhythms made a powerful sound. Then Lord Odysseus spoke. Mighty Alcinous, most renowned among all men, who claimed, you claimed your dances were the best, and now indeed what you said is true. When I gaze at them, I'm lost in wonder. At Odysseus' words, powerful King Alcinous felt a great delight and spoke at once to his Phaeacians, master sailors. Leaders and counselors of the Phaeacians, listen. This stranger seems to me a man with an uncommon wisdom. So come now, let's give him gifts of friendship as is right. 12 distinguished kings are rulers here and govern in this land, and I myself am the 13th king. Let each of you bring a fresh cloak and tunic, newly washed, and a talent of pure gold. All of this we should put together very quickly, so the stranger has his gifts in hand and goes to dinner with a joyful heart. Alcinous spoke. All those present agreed with him and said it should be done. Then every one of them sent an attendant out to bring back presents. As the sun went down, the splendid presents were brought in, carried to Alcinous' home by worthy heralds. The sons of noble Alcinous took the lovely gifts and set them down before their honored mother. Nausicaa, whose beauty was a gift from God, standing by the door of that well-built hall, looked at Odysseus and was filled with wonder. She spoke winged words to him. Farewell, stranger. When you are back in your own land, I hope you will remember me sometimes, since you owe your life to me. Then Odysseus, that resourceful man, replied to her and said, Nausicaa, daughter of great Alcinous, may Hera's loud-thundering husband Zeus grant that I see the day of my return when I get home. There I will pray to you all my days as to a god, for you, girl, you gave me my life. Odysseus finished speaking. Then he sat down in a chair beside King Alcinous, who then spoke out at once to his Phaeacians, lovers of the sea. Listen to me now, you Phaeacians, counselors and leaders. To any man with some intelligence, a stranger coming as a suppliant brings the same delight a brother does. And you, our guests, should no longer hide behind those cunning thoughts of yours and skirt the things I ask you. It's better to be frank. Tell me your name. What they call you at home, your mother and your father and the others, those in the town and the countryside. Tell me your country and your people, your city too, so ships can take you there, using what they know to chart their passage. And now come, tell me this and speak the truth. Where have you traveled in your wandering? What men's countries have you visited? Tell me of people and their well-built towns, whether they are cruel, unjust, and savage, or welcome strangers and fear God in their hearts.